So my understanding, this is the background talk, and then the talk about the new results will be at 4 o'clock. Is that right? Right. I think this is probably the same room that I talked in 1978. Is that possible at
no.
Milner Seminar? No?
No.
No. Okay. All right. Let's see. I'm going to begin really at the beginning. So
we didn't have to be in the 78 talk?
That's right. That was the year I met you, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, great. Okay, so let's see. Yeah, so to begin at the very beginning, a number field, as everybody knows, is just a finite extension of Q. And an example that's already a wonderful thing to study is Q adjoin squared of minus 1. And of course, the ring of integers. So let's say k is the number field. The ring of integers of k are just the elements that are roots of monic polynomials with integer coefficients. Those are a subring. And in this example, it turned out to be a z adjoin squared of minus 1, the Gaussian integers. So they're things of the form a plus bi, where a and b are in z. My understanding is that people started thinking about number fields because they realized that even if they were just interested in answering questions about integers, that the number fields were forced on them. And there's a wonderful example that's in Hirstein's book where he gives an application of the Gaussian integers to prove a famous theorem of Fermat, which says that every positive integer is a sum of two squares. Sorry, didn't get that quite right, did I? Okay, so a prime, he gives necessary and well, it's more general, but for example, a prime is a sum of two squares. Prime p, let's say, is a sum of two squares if and only if p is congruent to 1 mod 4. So you can give necessary and sufficient conditions for a general integer in terms of its factorization, but this is what it says for the case of a prime. And it's easy to see why this should be connected with the Gaussian integers, because if I write p equals a squared plus b squared, then it gives a factorization of p, meaning that even though it was prime in z, it is not prime, it's not irreducible in the Gaussian integers. So the analog of being prime in the integers is being reducible, which means it's an element, it's a product of two elements which are non-units. They're not invertible in the ring. And if the situation is non-degenerate, then these are both going to be non-units. So let's say, for example, if A and B are both positive or something like that, these will both be non-units, so A and B, so these will both be non-units, okay? And conversely, in fact, if the prime is reducible, then it's a sum of two squares. So P is a sum of two squares if and only if it's reducible. in the Gaussian integers, and so the point is that this question is equivalent to something about factorization in the Gaussian integers. And in fact, the main step in the proof of Fermat's theorem that you'll see in Hirstein's book is a unique factorization. Mod units. So unique factorization into irreducible elements, just like the fundamental theorem of arithmetic for this particular ring. And one thing that this illustrates, which I should mention right away, is that the structure of the group of units in, let's say, O, the ring of integers in K, is a crucial point in understanding structure of, well, of K or of O. And I didn't say what it was in this case, but in this case, it's in this example, it just consists of plus or minus 1 and plus or minus I. Okay? So now Hirstein actually does something kind of remarkable in the appendix to his algebra book. He uses a similar method to prove a famous result of Lagrange, which says that every positive integer is a sum of four squares. And what he uses there, instead of using a ring of integers of a number field, he does a non-commutative analog of that called the, I think it's Hurwitz, if I'm not mistaken, Hurwitz quaternions. So this is a subring. Non-commutative, certainly. It's a subring of the Hamiltonian quaternions. And I believe it consists of elements of the form A plus BI plus CJ plus DK over 2. Where, if I have this right, B plus C plus D is even. Hope I got that right. So these turn out to be a ring, and what I'll point out in just a minute is that this is kind of an analog of the ring of integers in a number field, and the term that's used here is that it's a maximal order in a quaternion algebra. So I'll be saying in just a minute what those words mean. But the point is that this is just as natural a thing to study as a ring of integers, and it has similar applications. So we should think of it as a kind of the integers in a non-commutative version of a number field. So the starting point then for the formal stuff I'll be saying is the definition of a quaternion algebra. So this is an associative algebra over a field K. I think I call it B. And it has a linear basis 1, which is of course the multiplicative identity, and then ij and k, and these satisfy some relations I squared equals alpha, J squared equals beta, IJ equals K, and JI equals minus K. So here, alpha and beta are just units in the field, non-invertible elements of the field, non-zero elements of the field. And of course, from this, you can easily read off the entire rule for multiplying two elements of the of the algebra. So the philosophy is going to be that a quaternion algebra, well, certain quaternion algebras over over number fields are themselves analogous to number fields. So the basic fact is, if you take if I take a quaternion algebra over a field of certainly characteristic zero, I think characteristic different from two is enough for everything I'm going to say. Well, it's either a division algebra, so it's like a skew field, every non-zero element is invertible, or it's isomorphic to the ring of 2x2 matrices over K. So of course, the interesting ones are the ones that are like the ones that are division algebras. Those are going to behave like number fields. And so now we come to the definition of an order. So an order in an algebra B, well, it's something that behaves somewhat like the ring of integers. So it's a subring which is generated as an additive group by a basis, by a linear basis for B. By the way, of course, these things are four-dimensional by definition, right? So generated by a linear basis for B. And certainly very easy to see from the definition of those Hamiltonian quaternions that they're in order in this sense. So this makes sense for any algebra, commutative or not, and it's easy to see that in a number field K, if you regard it as an algebra over Q, the ring of integers is the unique maximal order. So that's a nice characterization of it. However, if you instead of looking at a number field, if you're looking at a quaternion algebra over a number field, in general you have lots of maximal orders. So B is a let's say a division quaternion algebra. Over K, which let's say is itself a number field. Then, in general, you're going to have lots of maximal orders. Okay, so already things are more complicated. You don't have a canonical equivalent, even if you have the division algebra, which is like having the field. You don't have a canonical thing corresponding to the ring of integers.
Generated here, you mean?
As an additive group. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. So it's generated as an additive group. Thank you. Okay. Right. As a want to say, yeah, as, no, as an additive group, absolutely, right. No, no reference to the, no reference to the module structure, is that right? Yeah, that's correct. Okay, so, now what about, units? I said units were the other really basic thing besides integers, units in a maximal order. One fact about number fields is that the is that if I look at O star, so this is the group of units in the ring of integers, it's maximal in its commensurability class. So I'll remind you the definition of commensurability. That's something that makes sense anytime you're looking at groups. So if A and B are subgroups of a group gamma, then to say that A and B are commensurable means that their intersection is of finite index in both of them, and that's an equivalence relation. So again, this fails. Again, this fails in this case, and so there's no really canonical equivalent of the group of units. So the objects that I'm basically going to be considering today, which turn out to be I think a natural kind of analog of the group of units in a number field, but certainly less canonical. I'm going to consider subgroups of B star, where B is now a division quaternion algebra over a number field, which are commensurable with groups of units of maximal orders. And actually, it turns out to be nicer to study certain quotients of these groups, which I think contain probably all the same information as the groups themselves. So what I'll really consider is a group that I'll call, so let's look at groups of the form. I don't seem to have notation for this for some reason. Okay, let's just say. I guess I need a letter. Okay, let's use delta. So delta mod k star, where delta is. So delta is a subgroup of B star, commensurable with the units of a maximal order. And I don't mean that. So I don't mean delta mod K star. I mean the image of delta in B star mod K star. So K star is a central subgroup of B star, so we can form the quotient. So instead of looking at these groups themselves, I'm looking at their images in B star mod K star. Okay? All right. So basically, these are what I'm calling arithmetic groups. But there's a slight change of point of view because we want to identify them with certain lattices and certain Lie groups. Okay. So to do that, we want a way of extending the scalars. And this is, again, a very familiar thing in number theory. It's related to the real and complex places of a number field, okay? So a number field, so if K is a number field, then K has finitely many real places, which just means, well, necessarily injective homomorphisms. I mean, it might not have any, but it's still finitely many of K into the real numbers. So field homomorphisms. So, you know, for example, if you took Z adjoined root 2, you could take root 2 to the usual root of 2 in R, or you could take it to minus that. You get two different looking embeddings in R. And it also has finitely many complex places, which are complex conjugate pairs. You can choose one out of the pair, it makes no difference. Of homomorphisms from K into C, but which are not real. So the image is not contained in R. It might be more natural to call them imaginary places, but they're called complex places. Okay. Okay, so if I take a real place, you can identify, it gives you a way of identifying a K with a subfield of R, and then, now if B is a quaternion algebra, then under this identification, we can take the tensor product of B with R over K, and it's completely formal to see that this is a quaternion algebra. So it's a quaternion algebra over R, and I forgot to say a very basic thing, which is that up to isomorphism, there are only two quaternion algebras over R, and of course you can immediately see what they have to be. They're the Hamiltonian quaternions, which, for better or for worse, are usually denoted this way. And the 2x2 matrices over R. So that that extension then is one of these two things, and of course we can map X to X tensor 1, and this gives a homomorphism from B to either one or the other of these two things, either the Hamiltonian quaternions or the 2x2 matrices over R. And for the case where you get the Hamiltonian quaternions, you say that B is ramified at the given real place. Well, so then the point is that if I look at B star mod K star, then I get this homomorphism in the second case, in the unramified case. Well, no, I guess I can do it in both cases. So this will now come with a homomorphism into, well, it'll either be H star mod R star, which is compact Lie group. I believe it's just SO3. And in the other case, it's mapped into PSL2R. Okay, so we're dividing out by the real thing. So we're taking this and dividing out by the non-zero real numbers, PGL, I guess it is. Okay, so I said, and in the complex case, so another basic fact is that in the algebraically closed case, the only quaternion algebra is the matrix algebra. And so similarly, a complex place gives an embedding of B star mod K star into PGL2C. Okay. So the sort of very familiar thing to do from the point of view of number theory, then, since we have finitely many of these places, is to put all these together and get a diagonal map. So these actually give a diagonal map of B star mod K star into a product now of copies of these various groups. So we have a certain number of copies of PGL2R, one for each. I'll just put a box there so I don't have to write down what the number is. But we have one factor here for each place over which the quaternion algebra does not ramify. And then we have a bunch of SO3s corresponding to the ones where it does ramify. And then a bunch of PGL2Cs corresponding to the complex places. And it turns out to be an elementary fact using only what you would see in a basic Galois theory course, that if I take one of the groups that I'm interested in here, so if I look at the I didn't give a name to this image, so let me call it delta bar. I should have decided what to call it. Okay, so the image of delta bar under this diagonal embedding is discrete. As I say, that's elementary, but in fact, the really deep number theoretic fact is that, in fact, it's a lattice. That is to say, of finite covolume. In this Lie group. Okay. Now I got a little bit ahead of myself. The SO3 factors are kind of dumb because they're compact. So if you if you divide out by the compact group, then all this stuff about being discrete and being a lattice and so on is preserved. And so what you get there is an embedding in a product of PGL to R's and PGL to C's. And now it's time to write down, and follows from what I've said, what the numbers of factors are. So delta bar is now actually canonically isomorphic to a lattice. And I'll call something like this gamma. I think Borel actually uses the notation gamma O star. In PGL to R to the A cross PGL to PGL to C to the B, where A is the number of real places at which B is ramified, and B is the number of complex places. Sorry? I'm sure you're right. Unramified, thank you. Okay. Right. Okay. So these are the things I'll actually be talking about now for the rest of the hour. These are arithmetic lattices. Now, anybody can guess what my favorite example is, because of course. I like lattices in PGL to C. So the case that I may slip into talking about without necessarily emphasizing the transition, so my favorite case is when A equals 0, B equals 1. So in other words, B has only one complex place and ramifies at all real places. So those will give us the arithmetic lattices in PGL 2C. So it's only one case, but of course it's from the number theoretic point of view, but it's an interesting case and certainly a very rich one. Right. Well, of course, the great thing about having a lattice is that it has an extremely natural invariant, which is the covolume. So the covolume of gamma the covolume of gamma where gamma let's see, let me just make sure I yeah commensurate with units, that's right. The covolume of gamma, of course, we can think of as the volume of H3 mod gamma, and this is, if gamma were torsion-free, which certainly can be within the commensurability class, but it doesn't have to be, then this would be a hyperbolic manifold. So in general, this is a hyperbolic three-dimensional orbifold. Now, this turns out to be very analogous to something that number theorists study for number fields, which is called the discriminant. And I think the discriminant you can define in a very similar way. You take the field itself, you take a diagonal embedding defined by all the real and complex places, and it goes into, I guess in that case it would be a product of units in C and R, you would this is a kind of an abelian situation, but the image would again be a lattice, and again you'd look at the volume of the quotient. If I'm not mistaken, that's the discriminant. So it's a famous theorem of, I think it's Minkowski, that if you take a if you look at number fields, if you put an upper bound on the discriminant, never mind what the degree is, that can do whatever it wants, but you just take this one invariant, which is the discriminant, and you put an upper bound on it, then there are only finitely many number fields having at most that discriminant. So so what Borel did was he proved an analog of this for these quaternion algebras. So he proved that there are, in this language, there are only finitely many arithmetic lattices. Well, I mean, it's certainly true for any A and B, but I think I'm just going to focus on this case from now on. In PGL2C of a covolume less than or equal to V, say, where V is some positive number. Okay. So of course, as you can imagine, number theorists work very hard to, in the number field case, to try to make an actual list of all the fields with the most a given discriminant. It gets extremely difficult after a while. And naturally, this is an equally interesting problem from the number theoretic point of view. So the problem is, given some positive number, given V greater than zero, actually list all arithmetic lattices in PGL2C of covolume at most V. Or in other words, list all the hyperbolic orbifolds, all the arithmetic hyperbolic orbifolds of volume at most V. Okay? So I want to say a few words about how Borel's proof goes, because it turns out that there's a number theoretic component which is quite easy to control. And then there's some strange thing involved where topology and geometry actually turn out to be helpful. So the first thing he notices is that it's enough to consider maximal arithmetic lattices among those of volume at most V. Well, in fact, if it's maximal among things of volume at most, of covolume at most V, it'll be maximal among lattices, period, because when you make the lattice bigger, the volume goes down. The covolume goes down. So that's almost obvious, but what he proves, which I think is not obvious at all, is that every maximal arithmetic lattice is the image of something that's commensurable with a group of units in a maximal order. And in fact, he shows it's the image of something of the form the normalizer of O star. So I guess this would be the normalizer in B star of O star. So it's not too hard to show that this contains O star with finite index, But then he's saying anything that's maximal is actually the image of under that canonical embedding of something of this form. So I guess in other words, you would take this normalizer and then you would divide this by K star. You get something isomorphic to your lattice. Okay. So lattices that are of this form, a lattice of this form is here of course O is some maximal order. In some division quaternion algebra B. So this is something that's actually now canonically associated with O, I guess, and he denotes it by gamma O. No, the converse is not true. Notice I didn't say everything of this form is maximal. My understanding is that he proves that if something is maximal, then it's of this form. I wouldn't be surprised. Sorry?
I meant the order is not necessarily maximal. Because it might stabilize an edge of the
I see. Okay, yeah, you're probably right about that. Okay, so O is some order. Okay, I'm sure you're right. Certainly a point I hadn't been aware of. So these are the ones you'd like to know about. Now, actually, the argument that Borel gives directly applies very nicely to a certain class of lattices, but it's not exactly this class. So what Borel does, he gives a formula for the covolume, not of something of this form, of a somewhat different kind of lattice, a lattice that I'll call he calls gamma O1, and this is the image of the subgroup of O star. So again, O is an order, and I guess to be consistent, it doesn't have to be a maximal order, consisting of elements of reduced norm 1. Okay, so what's the reduced norm? Well, the abstract definition is you take if x is in B star, well, even in B, I guess, you look at x tensor 1 in B tensor, let's call it K bar. So that's the algebraic closure of K. And of course, we could identify this in C in the case where we have a complex place, but this works in general. So this is always isomorphic to the matrix ring, so we can just take its determinant. And the determinant of X tensor 1 is called the reduced norm. Okay. And in fact, well, basically, if the degree is very large, just to keep things simple, if the degree of K is large enough, which is not a very serious restriction, and you can weaken it, then the covolume of something of this type, gamma 1 O, according to this formula. I mean, he gives an actual formula for the covolume. I won't write down the formula, but it implies that when the degree is large enough, this covolume is bounded above by bounded below by a certain fixed fractional power of the discriminant of K.
I think his formula is from
It's a generalization, I think. It's a generalization of Humbert. At least that's what he says. So basically that means is using the fact, you know, dealing with this issue of low degree and using that there are only finitely many number fields of at most a given discriminant, you can, and then doing some extra work, of course, you can prove, you prove that there are only finitely many lattices of this particular type with a given volume. So this actually allows one in practice, it's not so bad. So this allows one in practice, for at least as long as the V is not so big as to make the computation too long, but in reasonable examples, you can actually list lattices of the form gamma O1 with at most a given covolume. So there's a gap here, okay? Because his method works directly for these things, but what he would really like is to do it for these things. And so then as the notation indicates, these things are actually canonically associated with orders. And it's not hard to show. It may actually be almost obvious that given any O, gamma O is gamma O contains gamma O1. But they're not the same. In fact, the quotient it's a normal subgroup, and the quotient is an elementary abelian 2 group. That just means it's a product of copies of Z mod 2. So what that means is then that the index of gamma O, gamma O1 and gamma O is for example, less than or equal to 2 to the R, where R is the dimension of the first homology of gamma 0, of gamma O, with mod 2 coefficients. Okay? So what does this tell us about volumes? Well, as I say, what we're trying to do is we're trying to list the things of the form gamma O with at most a given volume, okay? We know how to list the things of this form with at most a given covolume. So the point is that if the covolume of gamma zero is at most V, then what do we know about the covolume of the thing that we really have control over? So the covolume of gamma O1, so let's see, how does this go? It's equal to the covolume of gamma O times this index, okay? So in other words, it's at most V times 2 to the R. So I mean, if we sort of knew what this number was, then we would have a bound on the covolume of this. Then we can list the things of at most that covolume. That gives us the possibilities for this. And then Well, I mean, after that, we can sort of control what's going on. Okay. Yeah, ideally you'd like to make a list of them.
It's not a question of how they grow, it's X goes to
one. No, the asymptotic thing is a different question. So there is some work on were you involved in that? I know Lebowski was, right. Lebowski and some co-authors, I forget who. So this is sort of the other end. This is for, you know, give me a small number, not too big, and I'd like to list what they are. Okay. So how did Borel deal with this? He said, well, he quoted either Thurston or Jorgensen, and he said that if you have an upper bound on the volume of a hyperbolic orbifold, then it gives you some upper bound on the number of generators of it as a group, in particular on the rank of H1 with mod 2 coefficients, and then you can deal with this. He didn't have a number theoretic proof. There was a number theoretic proof of this bound in this case that was given by Chinburg and Friedman. They were able to use it to find all hyperbolic orbifolds of volume less than 0.041. There's only one of them. So in particular, they found the smallest hyperbolic orbifold. But beyond that, the algorithmic complexity kind of got out of hand. So that's the problem. That's the sort of the basic problem that I'm addressing now in my work. So the problem is given a bound on the volume of omega, where omega is a hyperbolic 3-orbifold, and well, in this context, it doesn't really have to be arithmetic, although, as I say, that's where my motivation comes from. Well, find a good bound, so one that's not astronomical, one that is actually useful for calculation, for the dimension of its homology with mod 2 coefficients. And by the way, this means the integer is mod 2. So that's, I'm still faithful to topology. Well, the reason this problem intrigued me was that by what I think is a miraculous coincidence, some joint work of mine over a period of 20 years with Marc Culler and others, we got some deep and interesting and sometimes close to sharp results, not quite for this question, but for the corresponding question about manifolds. So let me give you some sample results here. They look a little bit funny because they don't work for all volume. You don't get a bound on this for any bound on the volume. You get a bound for technical reasons. You get a bound on this as long as in terms of the volume, unless the volume is too big. So with Egel and Culler, I guess I should say Marc Culler, proved that. Let's say M is now a hyperbolic 3 manifold. You can assume it's closed; it doesn't really matter. Bad time. I do this the old-fashioned way. Okay. Okay, so if the volume of M is at most 1.22, then let's call it H, the dimension of H1 with Z2 coefficients is at most, I think it's 3, right? When we prove this, we really think contrapositively. So we're assuming some lower bound on the manifold, on the dimension, and we want to see how big a lower bound we can get on the volume. And that's what we were able to get.
What is the smallest volume? I see.
So actually, this particular result did not depend on Z2. In fact, you get a stronger result here for a prime different from 2. And for a prime different from 2, this bound is 2, and that's actually sharp. It's realized by the Weeks manifold when p equals 5. I don't know offhand. Does anybody know what the... Pardon? I thought the question was... I see. The smallest one is 0.94 something. I thought the question was what ranks of homology could occur in this range.
The question was, you have the number 1.22,
I think there are infinitely many of these. I think there are infinitely many. Is it known there are infinitely many in this range? I forget. Sorry? Finitely many. Well, finitely many known ones. I don't think so. Well,
okay.
Yeah, but that, okay, we should talk about that later. I don't think that's known, but I could be wrong. Okay, so Culler and I, actually this was improving a completely different result with Ego. Showed that if the volume is at most 3.08, then the dimension well, so you're saying there are finitely many, but you don't know what they are. Maybe that's the point, right? The dimension of this is at most I think it's 5. And then in another result that built on this using a lot of other stuff, if the volume is at most 3.44, then this H is at most 7. So I just want to conclude by pointing out that there's lots and lots of deep mathematics that goes into this result. I mean, into these results. The starting point is the so-called log 2k minus 1 theorem, which was proved in a kind of tentative form by Anderson, Canary, and Culler, and myself. In order to get the full result, we needed to use the solution to the tameness problem by Egol and Caligari-Gabay. But then it turned out that when you started to apply that, you got into some very, very deep three-dimensional topology. Maybe I should mention that the reason the number 2, you really do need the number 2 in these two results, for the modulus. The reason that number 2 comes in is because you need a Shapiro Whitehead style tower of covering. So there, of two sheeted covering. So there's really some very deep three manifold theory involved here as well. Also, some strange kind of topology involving the study of the nerve of a of a covering of a manifold by these so-called displacement cylinders, which gets very deep. And it turns out that those methods work except in a case where you have a certain kind of incompressible surface. And in that case, we were saved by the also very deep work due to Egel, Storm, and Thurston, which actually depends on Perelman's estimates for the behavior of the Ricci flow. So there's some really remarkable mathematics going on here, and I'm fascinated by the possibility that it may have something to do with number theory. So that's why I've been working so hard on trying to do the extension to orbifolds. And at 4 o'clock, I'm going to tell you what I know so far about this. Okay.
Here we can get started. Peter will continue talking about homology and arithmetic manifolds and orbifolds.
Well, thank you. So let me write down a theorem. It has some constants in it which fluctuate a little bit as the writing advances, but I'm just about at the point where I believe in them now. So let's let omega be a closed orientable hyperbolic 3-orbifold. Now suppose that the volume of omega is at most 1.72. Of course, you'll recognize that as being one half of 3.44, which appeared in the first talk. And for now, I also need some other assumptions. So assume that this is actually a harmless assumption from several points of view, but pi 1 of omega contains no triangle group. So you can always think of omega as being the quotient of H3 by a discrete group, which may have torsion. And so one nice concrete way of thinking about what pi 1 of omega means is that it's just that discrete group, okay? Assume also, and this is a much more serious assumption, that the singular set of omega is a link. So I'll have more to say about these assumptions in a few minutes, but I just want to record the statement. So then we get the following bound on the rank of H1 with mod 2 coefficients. So it's at most 5 plus 6 times the greatest integer in 10/3 times the volume of omega. Oh, sorry, 6 times sum of 2 terms. So the other term is roughly half this one. It's the greatest integer in 5/3 times the volume of omega. And so if you want to know what that means, I mean, if you plug in 1.72 here, you get 47. So that's in any case an upper bound. And so to illustrate the fluctuation I was talking about, I think that was 45 in the abstract. But so So again, before I make any comments about the statement, let me just point out that this actually follows immediately from formally from two propositions. So first we have something I'll call proposition A, which it sort of reduces this problem of getting a bound on H1 to getting bounds on the homology of certain ranks of H1 of certain manifolds with mod 2 coefficients. So proposition A, and here by the way, I'll come back to this, but so proposition A says, let omega be a closed orientable hyperbolic 3-orbifold whose singular set is a link. Then omega has this is a covering space, so it's a covering space in a category of orbifold, say a covering orbifold. Omega tilde of degree at most 2. So again, if you're thinking of omega as just being the quotient of hyperbolic 3 space by a discrete group, just means that this is the quotient by a subgroup of that discrete group, which has index at most 2, which has the following property. And the property is that if we want to estimate the dimension of H1 of omega, we can bound that in terms of H1 of certain manifolds. Namely, it's at most 1 plus the dimension of H1 of the underlying manifold of omega. So, an orbifold is if you want to think about the underlying manifold, again, if you're just thinking of it as a quotient of H3 by a discrete group, then you're just taking that as a space. It's just the quotient space. It turns out, in the orientable case, that actually is itself a closed 3 manifold. So that's all that means. And then plus the dimension of H1 of this, H1 of the underlying space of this two-sheeted covering. Okay, so that's nice because it means that if you want to bound H1 of the orbifold, it's enough to bound to know how to bound the H1 of the underlying manifold of an orbifold. But you have to do that twice. Okay, I think I call that proposition A. Okay. All right. So proposition B is actually going to tell you how you go about bounding such a thing in the case where, there are no triangle groups and the volume is at most 3.44. So proposition B will say, let omega be a closed orientable hyperbolic 3 orbifold with volume at most 3.44. And again, suppose, to get the particular bound I'm talking about here, I actually need the information about the singular set being a link as well. But so suppose that the singular set of omega is a link, And well, I guess that omega contains no embedded, I'm going to say pi 1 injective, although I don't think I even need that. I think that's a probably redundant condition, turnovers. So what's a turnover? It's just a quotient of the hyperbolic plane by a triangle group. And so I don't want to have any things like that sitting inside omega, at least with pi 1 injecting. So this is on the at least on the face of it, certainly a weaker condition than saying that it has no triangle groups. So in particular, it'll be true for the original orbifold or any two-sheeted cover of it. So then I guess we get that the dimension of H1 of omega with Z2 coefficients is at most, I think it must be 2 plus 6 times the greatest integer in 5/3 times the volume of omega. Make sure I have that right. Yeah. Okay. So formally these two taken together prove the theorem, because you start out with something that has volume at most 1.72, satisfies these conditions. It has a covering space such that these inequalities hold. And now, in particular, because omega had volume at most 3.44, both it and its two-sheeted cover, I'm sorry, it had volume at most 1.72, therefore omega and its two-sheeted cover both have volume at most 3.44. So you can bound these terms above using proposition B, and then you just plug in those upper bounds here, and you get the conclusion of the theorem. Okay. Probably. Oh, here. Yes, absolutely. Thank you. Good. Yeah. So that's the point, that this really is an estimate for the underlying manifold. Yeah. Okay, so what should I say about this? Well, let's see.
What's known by example? This 47.
Yeah.
What's known by sort of real-life examples? What's
that? I can't tell you. I can't tell you what's known in examples. But the way I think about this is that, you know, as I was saying in the first talk, we want to get a bound that's good enough, and this is probably not quite good enough. I think it's a little bit on the big side, but we want a bound that's good enough so that we can plug it into this Borel machinery that I was talking about and actually make a list of all the hyperbolic orbifolds. So it could happen that you would use this in making your list, and then when you made the list, it turned out, you know, they were never bigger than 5 or something. I don't know. Yeah. So that's the way I think about it. Okay. There could be people that know examples, but I'm not one of them. Yeah. All right. So right. So I guess I shouldn't dwell too much on the general picture of an orbifold. If you take locally near any point of an orbifold, it looks like the quotient of a vector space by a three-dimensional vector space by a finite group, and so there aren't very many finite groups that act on three-dimensional vector spaces, and so what you actually get is, it could actually look like a it could actually look like a manifold. If it's not a fixed point, if it is a fixed point, you might have a cyclic group, in which case the thing would look the singular set would be locally a one manifold, or it can be non-cyclic, in which case, because of the classification of finite subgroups of SO3, it looks like a graph, a trivalent graph near the point, and the points other than the vertex themselves have cyclic stabilizers, and you can label each of these edges with the order of that corresponding cyclic group, let's say P, Q, and R, and the restriction is that 1 over P plus 1 over Q plus 1 over R is greater than 1. So far, I need, for reasons that I'll be talking about, I actually need the assumption that the singular set is a link. So that means this picture is ruled out. We have only a one manifold for the singular set. And so in terms of the group, what that means is the singular set of H3 mod gamma is a link if and only if all finite subgroups of gamma are cyclic, which is really too strong a restriction for the application to arithmetic groups. So I need it so far. So let me say a word about why I need it. The most important place I need it is in proposition A. I don't know how to prove anything like proposition A without that assumption. Proposition B uses the assumption, but not in such a crucial way. If I haven't been through the calculation, so I don't know what the answer is, but if you take proposition B and you drop the assumption that the singular set is a link, you'll still get a result in the same, let's say, the same order of magnitude. It might be twice as big or something like that, or maybe not even that, but it'll be weaker. But I can do something like proposition B without this assumption, and for reasons that I'll be explaining, I can't do anything like proposition A without the assumption. Okay. What about the assumption of triangle groups? The assumption about triangle groups is actually harmless for, well, it's harmless for the application to arithmetic groups, first of all. The reason is, Ben Lenowitz explained this to me. If you have a triangle group inside an arithmetic subgroup of PSL2C, first of all, it's conjugate to an arithmetic. You have this rigidity property for triangle groups. So it's for general reasons, it's actually conjugate to a triangle subgroup inside PSL2R. But I think maybe non-trivial is that triangle group is itself arithmetic. So it's an arithmetic subgroup inside PSL2R. Now you know what I mean by that because I talked about the general picture this morning, triangle subgroups of PSL2C to such and such a power across PSL2R to such and such a power. So that includes arithmetic subgroups rather. So that includes talking about arithmetic subgroups of PSL2R. So the fact is, if you had a triangle group inside an arithmetic subgroup of PSL2C, it would be conjugate to a triangle to an arithmetic subgroup inside PSL2R. Now the arithmetic triangle groups are only finite in number. There's a short list of them, and they're all known. And once you have a triangle subgroup inside PSL2R, as a subgroup, you can also show. Remember, these arithmetic groups came from fields. You started out with a number field, and then you took a quaternion algebra over it. And I think that field is the invariant trace field, as it's called, but not important of the hyperbolic orbifold. But when you It turns out that the field associated with the original arithmetic group is a degree 2 extension at most of the field associated with this triangle subgroup. So because you can, you know, figure out what all the fields are associated with this triangle subgroup, well, you can, you know, figure out which degree 2 extensions of them come up. You control the discriminant and stuff like that. And then it turns out that you have enough number theoretic information to figure out everything there. So basically, once you have a triangle subgroup, you can sort of do anything you want to do. So they're really harmless for the application to number theory. And Ian has also told me that it may even be possible to get rid of them in the general statement, because if you have a triangle subgroup, it tends to mean that that you have some kind of big fat neighborhood of a turnover in the manifold, and you can get a good lower bound for the volume anyway. So from at least a couple of points of view, the triangle the restriction about triangle groups is not serious. The restriction about the singular set being a link certainly is. So let me talk about the proof of proposition A. That's kind of a simple proof. It's only one page of this so far 70-page paper. But as I say, it's a significant step, especially because it's really where the where it's so essential so far to have this assumption about singular set being a link. Okay, so proof of proposition A. So let's write M for the underlying manifold of omega. So we have a, let me just record some of the information that you have when you have an orbifold of this type for which the singular set is a link. So first of all, there's a canonical surjection from a fundamental groups, but in particular of homology. I'm going to just use Z2 coefficients. So anytime I write homology, it'll have Z2 coefficients. So we have a canonical surjection from H1 of omega to H1 of M. And I'll tell you something about it. So suppose we look at the components of the singular set of omega. Let's write them as S1 up to SM. So these are simple closed curves. They're the components of this link, which is the singular set. And now let's look at dual curves to these SI. So CI will just be a little simple closed curve bounding a disk which crosses SI in one point. And the disk will be disjoint from the other SI. So let's just say CI capital CI is the boundary of a small disk which crosses S sub I in one point. It's small meaning it's disjoint from the other SJs. So if I look at little CI, that's the homology class of big CI. I mean, just as in the manifold case, something like this determines a homology class. And the point is, it's actually in the kernel of this canonical surjection. In fact, the let's call it I gave a name to it. No, I guess not. So let's say K is the kernel of eta, then C1 up to Cm. These actually span this vector space K. All right. So this is all part of the basic picture that you have when you have an orbifold whose singular set is a link. Right, so if you can... Did I say something wrong? Okay, so let's re-index these things so that C1 up to CK form a basis, because there's a spanning set, so I'm just going to re-index so the first K of them form a basis for some K. K, so this is for some K is between, I guess a priori is between 0 and M. Of course, it's the dimension of K.
You already use the components with even order torsion of the stabilizer.
Let's see, so I have not said that these are all non-zero.
Sure, yeah, but I'm just saying, you don't need to take them.
No, but I think this works. No, I think you're right. Yeah, right. Okay. Okay, so now let's write H for the dimension of H1 of M, always with mod 2 coefficients, and so now I'm going to choose elements E1 up to E sub H in H1 of omega so that eta of E1 up to eta of EH form a basis of H1 of M. So now, I guess that implies that if I take the E's on the other things and the C's together, C1 up to CK, then these form a basis for H1 of omega. There's a degenerate case if K equals 0, I'll let you check that you can take omega tilde equals omega and you get a stronger estimate, I guess basically because there's no difference between H1 of the manifold and H1 of the orbifold in that case. So that's kind of a stupid degenerate case. So now I'm going to assume that H is greater than 0. I mean, K is greater than 0. So now let's define a I'm going to define a homomorphism phi from H1 of omega to Z2 by taking phi of Ci equals 1 for I between 1 and k, and phi of Ej, I think I take that to be 0 for j between 1 and h. And of course, that makes sense because these are a basis. Well, I don't know where the other CJs go, okay? So I'm going to re-index again now. Re-index the ones beyond the kth one. And I'm going to do that in such a way that phi of ci equals 1 for I between 1 and something called r, and it equals 0 for I greater than r. So here I guess r could be anything between k and m, if I have the notation right. Okay. Okay, so now I'm going to look at the involution now. So I have this is a non-zero homomorphism. So phi is not identically zero because k is greater than zero. So therefore its kernel is an index 2 subgroup, and so phi defines a two-sheeted cover omega tilde of omega. And the branch locus is the union of S1 up to SR. So SI tilde, which is the, okay, let's say P is the covering projection. So SI tilde, which is P inverse of S, this is again a simple closed curve. And if tau is the Deck transformation, which is an involution, then the fixed point set of tau is just the union of these guys, S1 up to SR. With tildes. And now I'm going to apply the Smith inequality, okay? So what it says in this case is that the sum over all non-negative integers d, there aren't too many of them that matter, of the dimension of hd of the fixed set of tau is going to be less than or equal to the same sum using what I should have said is that this is actually an involution of M tilde, which is the underlying manifold of omega tilde. So M tilde is really more precisely is a branch cover of M with this branch set and so on. Okay. So this is going to be less than or equal then to the sum of the dimension of HD of M. Okay. So in general, what do I need for this? Well, I can do this for any prime P. If I have an order p periodic transformation, of a space, it doesn't even have to be a manifold, I get this exact inequality if I take Z mod P coefficients. So the reason the Smith inequality works here is that tau has order 2, and the coefficients are in Z mod 2. So what have I got here? Well, these are, you know, this is just one dimensional. So H0 is just the number of components. H1 is also the number of components. They're simple closed curves. And the number of those components is R. So this left-hand side is just 2R. The right-hand side, well, this is a 3-manifold. So H1 and H2 have the same dimension. And it's what I've called little h, I think. Yeah, little h. So I have 2h plus 2 here, if I got it right. Check if that's the same as what's in my notes. Yeah. Okay, so that says that so R is at most h plus 1. And now I'm sort of done because what's the dimension of H1 of omega? I think I said it was H plus K. Is that right? And no. Sorry. Yes, that's right. It's H plus K. Now, K is at most R, right? So that's at most H plus R. And R is at most H plus 2. Mm-hmm. Sorry. Something wrong here. Well, yeah, it should be plus 1, but oh, I guess it's okay. So this is. This is the dimension of the space that you're acting on, not the dimension of the quotient. That was my mistake. Okay. So what I should have said, now I haven't really given a name to that, so let me just write out what it is. So this is at most 2 plus 2 times the dimension of HD of M tilde. Okay. Sorry?
For
one, that's right, thank you. Okay, so I should have said R is at most 1 plus the dimension of H1 of M tilde. Okay, so this is at most H plus R, so which is in turn at most 1 plus H plus the dimension of H1 of M tilde. And now I'm done because little h is the dimension of h1 of m. Okay. So it's a very simple argument, but try it for the case where the singular set is a link. I don't know how to get any useful information out of it. So that's proposition A. Okay, so in the remaining time, I want to give a few hints. So the other, 69 pages so far are about the proof of proposition B. And so I'll only be able to give, obviously, a few very broad hints about that. So I should remind you of the statement. So omega, is as usual. So the singular set is a link, which is not, as I say, not really crucial, but the estimate would be weaker otherwise. And pi 1 of omega does not contain any triangle subgroup. Okay. And then the conclusion is that we get this bound on dimension of H1 of the underlying manifold with mod 2 coefficients. It's less than or equal to, something involving volume. Which is in turn at most 47, that's the thing to remember, okay? So I guess as a preliminary observation, there's one case where you get a much stronger result, which is when the underlying manifold happens to be hyperbolic. And of course the volume is at most 3.44 here. Okay. Well, if the underlying manifold is hyperbolic, then it's I think it's a result due to Gromov. Although maybe there's a more direct proof, but the volume of the underlying manifold of omega is at most the volume of omega, which is at most 3.44. And then you can just take this manifold and apply one of these results with Marc Culler that I mentioned earlier. And this actually implies that the dimension of H1 is at most 7 with mod 2 coefficients. So you get a much stronger result in that case. Right. So the hard part is, of course, when omega is not hyperbolic, to get some information out of this. And what allows you to get started is Perelman, who tells you that even though this underlying manifold may not be hyperbolic, it at least has a geometric decomposition. And so I'm going to use an invariant which I call vol darts. So that's supposed to be a pronounceable and inoffensive way of ordering the names of various people who are involved in this. So there's Egil Storm Thurston and Dunfield and Sean Rafalski, who I think was the first person who did this in the applied this in the Orbifold case. So if C is an orbifold, and to make it interesting, think of it as not being closed, certainly not necessarily closed. A 3-orbifold. The definition of this is that it's I take the double of psi, which is again an orbifold. I'm certainly thinking of it as being orientable. Okay, so I'm taking the double of psi, which is also an orbifold, and I take its I take its Gromov volume as an orbifold and divide it by 2. Okay, so this means the double. Okay, you can double an orbifold just as you can double a manifold. So I guess the most basic thing to say about this is that if C is hyperbolic, then vol darts of C is just equal to the ordinary hyperbolic volume. And the critical thing that Egel, Storm, and Thurston proved, and which extends to the orbifold case, is that if theta is an incompressible surface, say an incompressible 2-orbifold in C, and if I split, so I can split C along phi, just as I would do in the manifold case, and I get an orbifold. Sorry, I want to call this omega. This is a closed one now. In omega, which is a closed orbifold. And in fact, maybe I'll take omega to be hyperbolic, because I think it always is in the application. So what I get is that the volume of omega is actually bounded above by this vol darts of the manifold that I get by splitting omega along theta, which some people denote this way, and I will for today's talk. Okay. Okay. So this is a deep result, I guess. I think that's the part that involves the Ricci flow and so on. So now if we're back in the situation of the of proposition B, the underlying manifold of omega is not going to be hyperbolic, but M contains a canonical system of spheres and tori, let's call it S. So I think of S, I'm thinking of S as a two-dimensional submanifold. Of course, dividing it into geometric pieces. So canonical is an overstatement here. The spheres aren't canonical up to isotopy, they're canonical up to some complicated moves, which actually turns out to be very important for the proof, although it's the part I won't get up to. But let's choose S, let's say, among all such systems of spheres. So it's up to isotopy, but eventually it's up to a weaker equivalence relation. So as to minimize the number of points of intersection between S and the singular set of omega. Okay. And then when I've done that, S is actually going to be the underlying set of a of an incompressible 2-orbifold. And I will be able to apply this inequality. Let's call this star. So I want to apply star, and well, for it to be meaningful, I want to bound. So I mean, I know that this is at least, at most 3.44. So I know that, vol darts of that split thing. It's going to be at most 3.44. So I want to combine this with some kind of comprehensible lower bound. Which I can relate to homology. Okay, so that's the, in broadest possible terms, that's the plan. And now there are actually two ways of getting this lower bound. So one of them is, it's really a generalization of the, one way of getting a lower bound I mean, of course, this is really, of course, this is the sum over all the components of this thing, of vol darts of the component. So I really want a lower bound for each, a way of finding a lower bound for any term in here. And there are two ways to find lower bounds for one of these terms. Well, one of them is a generalization of something I've already talked about, and the other is another crucial observation in the paper of Egel, Storm, and Thurston. Okay, so the first one is, well, if it so happens that the underlying manifold of C is hyperbolic, well, I shouldn't quite say that, because the underlying manifold is in general going to have sphere and torus components. Everybody knows, well, everybody who's three-ish knows what I mean by hyperbolic if they're torus components. If they're sphere components, then I want to cap them off. So this means the underlying manifold of C with each sphere boundary component capped off by a ball. So if that thing is hyperbolic, then I get an easy lower bound. Ian explained to me how to do this, but it turns out that the lower bound is without the cap, it's at least the volume of this hyperbolic manifold. Okay. So now for that you don't even need this fancy vol darts construction. You need it for the second kind of lower bound. And as I say, this is where the crucial applications came up in the paper by Egel, Storm, and Thurston. So number two involves the characteristic submanifold, or the characteristic suborbifold, rather. of C. Let's call that sigma. So it's like a characteristic submanifold. I believe it's a suborbifold whose, it's a nice canonical thing, up to orbifold isotopy. Its components are I think S1 bundles and I bundles over two orbifolds, and they're embedded in a nice way. They meet the boundary of this orbifold C in nice ways, and so on. And just as in the manifold case, you can define the kishkas or guts of C just to be the union of all components of the complement of this. So C minus phi, C minus sigma, with negative orbifold Euler characteristic. And then what Egelstorm and Thurston did in the manifold case, and it works as well in the orbifold case, and it's the key result is a result due to Miyamoto about manifolds with totally geodesic boundary and their volumes. What you can show then is that Vol darts of C, another lower bound for it, which is going to be crucial for the argument, is something called V oct minus the Euler characteristic, minus the orbifold Euler characteristic of the kishkas of C. So let's see. You can define an Euler characteristic for an orbifold just as for a manifold. The bar just means I'm changing the sign, so you don't go nuts with minus signs. So chi bar just means minus chi, and V oct means this is a volume of a regular ideal hyperbolic octahedron, which is 3.66 on points east. Okay. I'm running out of time, but now the idea is to try to use these two kinds of lower bounds for the various pieces and try to relate them to homology. So maybe I should just say in the first case I talked about then, where the thing happens to be hyperbolic. So if the underlying manifold of C capped off is hyperbolic, the lower bounds for Vol darts, lower bound, one for Vol darts, is related to homology. Why? Precisely because of those It is related to H1 of C by the results that I mentioned in the first talk. Egal, color and Shalen, etc., involving relating H1 to volume in the hyperbolic case. So, I mean, if you had only hyperbolic pieces, then you'd be, you know, the whole thing would be really, really awfully easy. And the so, of course, the problem then, the whole difficulty then becomes to so the difficult step is relating let me put it this way, is really getting lower bounds. For chi bar of Kish Psi in the case where Psi, and for that matter, maybe the other pieces are not hyperbolic. So for example, you know, your whole manifold the manifold M, which is the underlying manifold of the orbifold omega, it could be homeomorphic to a connected sum of S2 cross S1s. There would be nothing hyperbolic in sight. And when you split open, you get a sphere with holes. Well, why should it have any Kishkas at all? And it may not. So actually what you have to do is you have to modify that system of spheres in that case and find a system that does have some Kishkas. So for example, if you have so each sphere in that case is going to be covered by pieces that are intersections with components of the characteristic sub-orbifold, and things that are just annuli containing no singular points. And if they all look like that, then you don't get any estimate directly at all. So you actually have to analyze what those things can look like. So for example, one thing that can happen is you take a certain sphere. On one side of this sphere, you have one collection of, let's shade these things, which are sort of its intersection with the characteristic, or the underlying set of its intersection with the characteristic sub-orbifolds. There are really some singular points in there in general. And on the other side, you might have a completely different, so the whole thing is covered by, you know, it's all covered by things like this. So you could have one thing like this, then you have an annulus, then beyond that annulus, you have another thing like that, and so on. Okay, so that's what you see on one side of the sphere. But on the other side of the sphere, you might have a completely different decomposition. You might have the curves on the other side might cross the curves on this side. Well, interestingly enough, that's a good thing if that happens. Because when you have that kind of clash, it's a standard observation in the theory of the characteristic submanifold, and it works in the orbifold case as well, that when you remove that sphere, the resulting thing does have some Kishkas. It's not entirely filled up by this characteristic submanifold and these trivial little product pieces or whatever of Euler characteristic zero. That's sometimes called, I think, the breaking windows argument or the Vegematic argument, and it actually works in your favor in this case. So it turns out that the bad case is when you don't have any of those clashes, where the things do fit together nicely. But in that case, you know, you can do good things too. An example of what you can do is you can have a whole submanifold that's made up of, for example, solid tori in the split open manifold, split open picture. It's made up of even orbifold solid tori, and they fit together very nicely. The when one hits a sphere, you have something from the other side that's hitting the sphere in the same annulus. And then if you take the union of all those things, you get a kind of a contraption whose boundary components are tori, and there are no singular points on those tori. And then using some sort of standard three-manifold ideas, you can actually show that torus is inside, that torus is the boundary of a solid torus, which contains this entire gadget. And that means that unless the whole manifold is just say a Lens space or S2 cross S1, in which case your conclusion is trivial, that the components of this gadget you've constructed really are solid tori. Well, if that happens, in fact, it's very easy to show that you don't, that, you know, it, actually to get a contradiction, because inside that solid torus, it's, you know, there's a system of annuli, which are these intersections with these spheres I was talking about, and there has to be an outermost annulus. When you look at that outermost annulus, you very quickly get a contradiction. That's all still preliminary to the really hard combinatorial step, which involves changing these configurations of spheres to make it look like this example that I just gave that incomprehensible explanation of. Okay, so I think it's time to stop.